Hello and welcome to the Westlake service online today for the 8th of November. It's wonderful to see you all and I'm really glad that you're able to join us and enjoy the service with us. Right, our ministries this week that we're focusing on, obviously in the times of COVID everything is a little bit different, but we have got videos of Stephen Ministries and how they're operating during this time, and also Women of Westlake and how they're working. So if you would like to find out more, just watch these now.
Hi, I'm Karen, in case you don't know me. I'm a Stephen minister.
And I'm Catherine, and I'm also a Stephen minister. Stephen Ministry is a confidential Christian care ministry. We are not counsellors, we are carers. We have undertaken 50 hours of training over a 20-week period to be able to listen, to encourage, and to pray with you when you go through difficulties.
We're also called the after people. When your life has fallen apart, when your marriage is not going well, after the funeral when everybody's left, when the kids are all gone and the house is empty, or you find yourself in a strange country, you're looking after your children and your husband's gone off to work and traveling all the time. We're there for you, to walk alongside you for as long as you may need. That's what we do, and that's what we're here for.
We will be available for you. We will come alongside you and support you, and we will listen to you. The Stephen Minister will be your person during your time of need.
You can contact either Catherine or myself by personal email, which will be on the screen, or you can just email stephenministry@westlakechurch.com.
Thank you.
Hi everyone. Today we would like to talk to you about Women of Westlake and share a bit more about WOW. Women of Westlake are a diverse community of women from different nationalities and countries from across the world. And we gather every Wednesday morning at 9:45 to study the Word of God. We share, we grow, and we serve together in our community. And we're also passionate about learning more about Jesus Christ and our faith. And we do that through biblical-based studies. And Sandy will now share a bit more about our current study.
Our current study is called Lioness Arising, and it's by author and speaker Lisa Bevere. In this study, Lisa uses examples from nature, along with biblical references, to call women to rise up in strength and numbers to change our world. The study ends on the 18th of November, but a new Bible study led by Kemi Oladapo will begin on the following week.
And if you would like to join us, please reach out to us on wow@westlakechurch.com. And you can join anytime, so reach out to us and we will then send you the Zoom link. Hope to see you at WOW.
See you there.
Our worship team are now going to lead us in a time of worship. So let's just ready our hearts to explore God in this way. Give an offering to the church. If you'd like to watch this video, that would be brilliant as to how you can do that. Obviously, I know so many of you already give a weekly offering, and we are so grateful for that, and we really do thank you for those donations.
If you would like to make a financial donation to Westlake Church, you may do so by going to westlakechurch.com. In the upper right corner, you will see a tab for giving. Upon clicking that, you will be taken to the Giving website. From here, you can see different options you have for giving, the first of which is through bank transfer. There's also e-payment and post office payments using a BVR. If you would like to give a donation through e-payment, click on the e-payment page. From here, you are able to select the amount that you would like to give, the type of payment, and input any information that you need to. At the bottom of the page, when you have completed all of the boxes, you simply need to click Securely Transmit Donation. We thank you for contributing to Westlake Church at this point in time.
We just wanted to put something in here for the youth to give you a little something to think about, something just to get your brain turning, so to have a little bit of fun. I am going to balance on one leg the whole time that we're doing this, so I'm hopeful that Megan is going to talk pretty quick. So, here we go.
So while Tommy's balancing, we wanted to focus on and give you some challenges to think about through a passage in Philippians. So if you have your Bible, turn to Philippians chapter 3, verse 17.
Quickly.
chapter 3, verse 17 says, "Brothers, join in imitating me and keep your eyes on those who walk according to the example you have in us." And so Paul in this passage is talking about looking to people who are good examples of living a godly life, of who are good examples of putting Christ first and of showing others his love as well. And those are the people we should be focusing on as we're trying to stand firm in our faith.
And something else that he says in Philippians is to fix your gaze on Jesus. And then I think that's one of the things, even as I balance now, I'm trying to look at one particular thing, because if I focus on one thing, it's a lot easier for me to stay balanced. So I'm just gonna keep looking forward.
And the third thing that Paul talks about in this passage in Philippians, actually in chapter 4, verse 1, he wraps up by saying, "Therefore, my brothers, whom I love and long for, my joy and crown, stand firm, thus in the Lord, my beloved, stand firm." And so he wraps up by saying, stand firm in your faith, stand firm in what you know is true, stand firm in who you are. And you can tell that I have a much easier time of standing firm because I have 2 feet on the ground. I'm planted in what I believe in. I'm planted on something solid, which we know that the Bible is and that our relationship with Christ can be. And so Tommy is struggling a little bit with quite being balanced in his faith.
I'm growing tired.
but we wanted to just encourage you to put your other foot down, to really focus during this time, as we've been talking about soul care as a church, to stand firm in your faith, to become more firm in what you believe and in who you are as a Christian, and especially in sharing that with the rest of the people around you.
And fix your eyes on Jesus and follow God the examples. Have a great Sunday.
Bye.
Over to James now as he leads us in a preach on Hebrews 10, which he's subtitled Under Pressure. Over to you.
In the past have called me a nut, but watching that video, I did feel a bit like a nut. 2020 has put more people under more pressure than I can ever remember. And the question I want us to think about today is, how do we avoid becoming like that nut that cracked under the pressure? The book of Hebrews was written specifically as a kind of sermon to people who were under a great deal of pressure from persecution. It was probably written to Jewish Christians in Rome. And they were under pressure to give up on their faith and go back to Judaism. And what I want us to do now is to look at a passage that sort of sums up the whole of the book of Hebrews. And so it's got, in a condensed form, what we need to hear about being resilient under pressure in this strange year that's 2020. And the passage comes from Hebrews chapter 10, beginning to read at verse 19. "Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened up for us through the curtain, that is his body, And since we have a great high priest over the house of God, let us draw near to God with a sincere heart and with the full assurance that faith brings, having our hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience and having our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another, and all the more as you see the day approaching. Now, basically, when it comes to handling pressure, that passage is about what we need to know and then what we need to do as a result of what we know. So, let's think about that. To stand up under pressure, what do we need to know? And basically, we need to know what Christ has done for us. You'll find that in verses 19 to 21. Therefore, brothers and sisters, since we have confidence to enter the most holy place by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way opened up for us through the curtain, that is his body, and since we have a great high priest over the house of God. Now, what we've got there in those three verses is a fantastically condensed summary of everything the writer's written in the previous 10 chapters. Now, you could sum up the whole of the book of Hebrews, its whole message, and the message of these three verses in just three words. Jesus is better. And so in these verses, we're told Jesus is a better sacrifice, because Jesus' blood, unlike sacrifices in the temple, which had to be repeated, Jesus' blood, his sacrificial death, has dealt with our sin once and for all. It's completely forgiven us. And Jesus is better than the temple. In the temple in Jerusalem, just one man on one day of the year was allowed to enter the symbolic presence of God that's called the Holy of Holies. But now, through Jesus, we all have access to God at any time. And finally, again, drawing in all this material he's been writing about in chapters 1 to 10, Jesus is a better high priest. The writer's just been saying how that the sacrificial work of the high priest in the temple was repeated time and time and time again. But Jesus is a better high priest, because the sacrifice that he offered his own life never had to be repeated. And he sat down at the right hand of God, which symbolises that everything that needed to be done for our salvation has been done. Now, if you'd been a Jewish reader reading those verses, there are four words that would really have surprised you, that you wouldn't have expected to be together in a passage of scripture. Most holy place, and then the fourth word, confidence. You see, they had no confidence in entering God's presence, but because Jesus is better in all of those ways that we've just described, sinners like us are made holy and can enter God's presence with confidence. Now, what we've got in those three verses, all this discussion of Jesus and what he's done for us, is what theologians call the finished work of Christ. And the writer of Hebrews wants us to know that because of the finished work of Christ, because Jesus' death and life and resurrection has done everything that needs to be done for our salvation, we now have, and he talks about, a sincere heart and full assurance that faith brings, and hearts sprinkled to cleanse us from a guilty conscience, and our bodies washed with pure blood. And I really wish we had time to unpack all of those, but we don't today. But in essence, what he's saying is that because of the cross, because of the atoning death of Jesus for your sins and his resurrection, you're clothed in Christ's righteousness. You're redeemed and forgiven and reconciled to God. And you have the full assurance, not a doubt or a worry, that you're saved. Not because of your goodness, not because of your smartness, but because of the blood of Christ. Because Christ took your place on the cross. Now, let's just think for a moment why the writer spent 10 chapters all of this really deep theology. I encourage you to go back and read it. And now he's summed up again just to make sure that we haven't missed it. Why has he done that? Because you see, the only firm foundation for a resilient life is a firm grasp of who Jesus is and what he's done for us as his people. You see, if you don't understand Jesus, if you don't understand what he did on the cross for you, if you don't understand the impact that's meant to have on your life, then you won't live the kind of life that God wants you to live and has enabled you to live and will allow you to live and handle the pressure we're talking about. And so the writer, before he begins to talk about some really practical stuff that we need to do to live a resilient life that doesn't crack under pressure, he wants us to know and grasp that we now have confidence. We now have assurance. We now have the freedom because of the sacrifice of Christ to enter God's very presence. He wants you to realise that because of the cross, because of what Jesus has done for you, you have access to God. That's an objective reality for every believer. And now he's going to go on and say, this is what you need to do because this is true. This is what God's people should do because of what Jesus has done for us. And that's really important that there's a principle here. You see, according to the New Testament, knowing the right things is the foundation for living the right way and experiencing the right things. So how are we going to withstand pressure and not crack like that nut? Well, the starting place is knowing and understanding what Jesus has done for you through his work, through his atoning, saving work, and then living in the light of it. So that's what we need to know. Now let's think about what we need to do because of what Christ has done for us. And basically, because of what Jesus has done for us, the writer tells us that there are three things that we can do, and in fact, they are commands, three things that we must do to build resilience into our life. Can I tell you the secret of a resilient Christian life according to Hebrews? Lettuce. No, not the kind that you read. I wonder if you noticed as we read that there were three lettuces in our passages. Three things that we can and need to do because of what Jesus has done for us. Let us draw near to God. Let us hold unswervingly to the hope. And let us consider one another. And if I was summing up those commands, I'd say that in order for us to build a resilient life that can handle the pressure that we're under, we need to enter, we need to endure, and we need to encourage. So let's think about each of those in turn. We're given a command in verse 22, let us draw near to God. In fact, what it's saying is let us keep on, keeping on drawing near to God. A lifestyle of drawing close to God. Now we talked a little bit earlier on about how in the Old Testament and in the temple, only one man, the high priest, once a year, could enter the very presence of God and enjoy intimacy with the Almighty. And that just for a short time. But we've been told here that as New Testament believers, because of what Jesus did for us on the cross, we can enter the very presence of God through Christ at any time and in any place. Wherever we are, whatever is happening in our lives, we can draw near to the ruler of the universe. I remember the rigmarole that we had to go through when there was a royal visit when I was in the police. All the barriers to getting near the royal family. But here, the King of Kings gives us an invitation when we're under pressure, and he says to you, draw near. If you're confused right now, draw near. If you're afraid right now and anxious about the future, draw near. If you're feeling down, draw near. And if you're feeling rejected, God says, draw near. And I can't tell you how, and I'm not sure how to theologize it, but what I know from my own experience and experience of so many other people that I've talked to is that when we draw near to God, we are changed. And maybe because we draw near to God in prayer and worship, circumstances change. So draw near to God. So we enter and then we endure. We're told that if you're going to really stand up under pressure, this is what we need to do. Verse 23, let us hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, for he who promised is faithful. And the word hold there, it isn't a kind of gentle thing. It's about gripping as tightly as you can, holding on to dear life, gripping it in a way that you never let go. And the second word, unswervingly, means not to be bent by something. So let's put them together, gripping something really tightly and not being bent. Do you see what it means when we bring that together? It says that if we hold on to the gospel, if we keep believing the gospel and living in the light of it, then we won't bend and buckle under the pressure of life. If we hold on to the hope of the gospel, nothing that this life can throw at us can destroy us. Not even what you're going through right now. And this isn't holding on to blind optimism, or it's not something about positive thinking. This hope isn't a vague wish. The writer reminds us it's a certainty. Because you see, it's guaranteed by God himself. He says that we can hold unswervingly to this hope. Because you see, its fulfillment doesn't rely on us. It's not in our hands. It relies on the one who promised. He who promised is faithful. This hope we're talking about is the knowledge that as believers, every day of our life and every moment beyond it, as a believer, we can say with truth, on the basis of God's own promises made to us, that the best is always yet to come. No wonder just a few chapters earlier in chapter 6 and verse 19, talking about hope, the writer says hope is the anchor of the soul. An anchor gives stability, and the only real stability that comes in life comes from having our lives anchored in the hope of the gospel, the good news of who Jesus is and what he's done for us. And with our lives anchored in the hope of the gospel, we can handle whatever life throws at us. We can stand whatever pressure 2020 or 2021 will put us under. We hold unswervingly to the hope we profess, remembering that he who promised is faithful. So we handle pressure by entering God's presence. We handle pressure by enduring and holding on to the hope of the gospel. And finally, we handle pressure. The word that comes to mind is encourage. I can remember being in Colorado and being amazed, looking up at the hillsides and seeing the aspen forests and how they were able to withstand the storms and the wind and the snow and yet cling on to those rocky hillsides in the Rocky Mountains. And somebody who was with us explained that these trees can withstand the storms because you see they're connected to each other through their roots, and they draw on each other's strength to withstand the storms. Well, we're reminded here in Hebrews 10 that the same thing is true for us as believers. Christians are like aspen trees because we withstand pressure through being connected to one another. We withstand pressure in life through being connected to other believers in Christian community, in Christian fellowship, in the church. Now, I know that as a pastor and church leader, what I want to know is, how do we create this fellowship that connects us in a way that allows us to withstand the storms of life? Well, we're told here that I think this is maybe the most important couple of verses about Christian fellowship in the whole of the New Testament, verse 24. Let us consider one another in order to stir up love and good works, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. Now, we need to do a little bit of detailed looking at this verse here, and I want to point out to you something. Often when people read that verse, they think the focus is on to stir up. That's the verb, but it's not. That's actually a noun. The main verb, in other words, the thing that we have to do, we are commanded to do, is consider. And so the verse isn't saying, consider how to love each other and do good deeds. Although that would be a Christian thing to do and a good thing to do. The object of the word consider is one another. So, if we put that together, what we have to do to create Christian community that helps us all stand up under pressure starts by considering one another. That's the command. That's God's call for us. We are to consider one another. That is, we have to look at one another. We have to think about one another. That involves getting to know one another. Authentic Christian community is created when we focus not on ourselves, but when we start focusing on other people. When we consider them, when we think about them, when we care about them. When we get to know what they're facing in life. When we consider what they are going through. So genuine fellowship, the starting point, this is so important, is when we take the focus off ourselves and what's going on in our lives and think about what's going on in the lives of those who are part of our fellowship. And we don't just think about it, we do something about it. We think, what needs to happen in the life of this other person? What can I do to help them experience love? What can I do to help them practically? Because that's what it means when it says to do good deeds. We have to consider the lives of other people in the fellowship so that it stirs up love and good deeds. And so the goal of considering each other in community is to think of ways of stimulating love and good deeds among us all in community. When you think about it, this is about having the mindset, when it comes to church, of a contributor rather than a consumer. So many Christians approach church and Christian fellowship with the mindset of a consumer. What can this church do for me? What can this church do for my family? How can this church meet my needs? And so what happens, of course, is if they feel the church isn't meeting their needs, they leave to find another one. They just want to consume what churches have to offer. Do you see how different what we're being told here about Christian fellowship? Whenever we approach Christian fellowship with the mindset of a contributor, we're looking around and we're thinking, what can I do to contribute to these people's lives? What can I do to make people feel more loved in this community? What good deeds, what practical things can I do to help these people with what they're facing in life? Who can I encourage? Now, the writer says something that's really obvious, but it needs to be said. You won't experience Christian fellowship in the way we are describing unless you actually show up and meet up with people. And that's why he says, not giving up meeting together as some are in the habit of doing, but encouraging one another. And listen, to consider someone, you need to do more than sit beside them in a worship service once a week. And that's why as a church, we are constantly encouraging people to get connected in small groups beyond Sundays. That's where this kind of fellowship happens. If you want to stand up under pressure rather than crack under it, I think the single most helpful thing that you can do is get connected to other believers in small groups and be faithful meeting with them. And everything we're thinking about is kind of summed up when he says that if we do all this, we'll encourage one another. Here's how I think the writer of Hebrews is telling us that Christian fellowship works in practice. We meet with fellow believers and we consider what's going on in their life. We get to know them beyond the superficial, and then we do what we can to express practical love and care for them. And when that happens in a community, people are encouraged. Now, encouragement in the Christian sense isn't that kind of friendly slap in the back. Encouraging one another in the New Testament sense in Christian fellowship is about strengthening another person with spiritual strength so that that person can withstand any hardship that they're experiencing. And right now, some of us are facing illness and financial problems and relationship breakdowns and depression and anxiety and job insecurity and worries about our families back home. And I believe that what Westlake needs more right now than ever, especially when we can't meet face to face, is for us to consider one another. For us to take our focus off ourselves and think about other people in the community and find out what they're going through right now and encourage them by doing whatever we can to express love and practical help. That may just be a word, a text message, a WhatsApp, or a phone call, or a visit, or a meal, or a financial gift, or maybe occasionally a sanctified kick up the backside. We need this kind of fellowship right now more than we have ever needed it. Let's put this into practice. So because of the finished work of Christ, we can handle the pressures of life by entering God's presence, by enduring what is happening, by holding on to the hope of the gospel and encouraging one another by taking the time to get to know one another and helping one another. So let's do it.
It's been excellent having you all join us. And I'd like to say now that if you'd like to come and join us for the Zoom, you are more than welcome, providing you're watching this on with us today on the 8th. The link is available on the email that I sent earlier in the week. If for any reason you haven't got that link, just email us on contactus@westlakechurch.com to receive the link straight away. See you soon. Bye.